My dear students, now we are going to see the 5th unit, Energy Management Audit Conservation. முதல்ல வந்து நம்ம எனர்ஜி வந்து அபண்டண்ட்டாக இருந்தது, அதனால் அதை பற்றி யாரும் ஒரி பண்ணிக்காம செலவு பண்ணிட்டு இருந்தாங்க. இப்போ அதை வந்து சீக்கிரமாக நம்ம பயன்படுத்துறதுக்கு அந்த மெத்தடாலஜி இப்போ தேட ஆரம்பிச்சிட்டாங்க. ஸோ அதுக்கு தான் வந்து அந்த 5th யூனிட் வந்து உங்களுக்கு வச்சுருக்காங்க. ஸோ அதை நம்ம டீட்டெயிலாக பார்க்க போகிறோம். ஸோ ஃபஸ்ட், வாட் இஸ் எனர்ஜி மேனேஜ்மெண்ட்? Energy management is the process of monitoring, controlling and conserving energy in a building or organization. Next, energy audit. Energy audit is defined as the verification, monitoring and analysis of use of energy, including submission of technical report containing recommendations of improving energy efficiency with cost benefits and analysis, and an action plan is reduced to reduce energy consumption. Need, தேவை. In an industry, the main three main operating expenses are energy, labor and materials. Out of these three, energy is the most costly. So to find out the potential of cost saving, some among the three, energy is the suitable choice. Helps in identifying the areas of energy wastes and where scope for improving it's necessary. Improving is necessary. Give a clear idea about the energy cost reduction, preventive maintenance and quality control programs. Helps to keep track of on disparity in energy cost, availability and reliability of supply of energy, decide on appropriate energy mix, identify energy conservation technologies, retrofit of energy conservation equipment, etc. by conducting energy audit programs. To determine ways to reduce energy consumption per unit of product output or to lower operating cost. Provides a benchmark reference point for managing energy in organization. Provides the basis for planning a more effective use of energy throughout the organization. What are the types of energy audit? There are two types. One is preliminary audit and other is detailed audit. Energy management audit approach. Preliminary energy audit methodology. It is also called a walkthrough audit, screen audit, screening audit. Preliminary audit, energy audit is the simplest and least expensive way to establish energy consumption in an organization and to estimate the scope for saving. The audit involves the following procedures. Identify the most likely and the easiest way for attention. Identify immediate incremental savings. Set a reference point. Identify areas for more detailed steady measurement. Preliminary energy audit uses existing or easily obtaining dates. Preliminary audit gives energy conservation measures and opportunities. Estimate in implementation cost, payback period, detailed energy audit methodology. It is also called a general audit or insight energy audit. This method of audit also collects information of system operations but is more detailed form of as compared in the simple audit. Energy conservation measures which are identified in the preliminary audit evaluates all respect in detailed audit. This type of audit offers the most accurate estimate of energy savings and costs. Proper metering in the system may perform a major role in this type of audit. in addition to data provided by utility, specific energy consumption in the system is metered. Detailed energy auditing is carried out in three phases. Phase 1, pre-audit phase. Phase 2, audit phase. Phase 3, post-audit phase. 10 steps methodology for detailed energy audit. Step 1, phase 1, pre-audit phase. Plan and organize. Walkthrough audit, informal interview with energy managers, production in plant managers, purpose or results, resource planning, establish organize an energy audit team, organize instruments and time frame, micro data collection, familiarization of process plant activities, first hand observations and assessment of current level operating and practices. Step 2. Conduct a brief meeting program with all divisional heads and person concerns. Building up cooperation, issue questionnaire for each department, orientation, awareness, creation. Step 3. Phase 2 audit phase, preliminary data gathering, process flow diagram and energy utility diagrams, historic data analysis, baseline data collection, prepares process flow charts, all service utilizes system diagram, example single line power distribution diagram, water, compressed air and steam distribution, design water compresses air and compressed air and steam distribution, annual energy bill and energy consumption pattern, refer manual, log sheet, nameplate and interviews. Step 4. Conduct survey and monitoring, measurements, motor survey, insulation and lighting survey with portable instruments for collecting of more and accurate data, confirm and compare operating data with design data. Step 5. Conduct a detailed trial experiments for selected energy gauges. Trial experiments, 24-hour power monitoring, MDPF, kilowatt-hour, etc. Load variation trends in pumps, fans, compressors, etc. Boiler efficiency trials, furnace efficiency trials, equipments, performance experiments, etc. Step 6. Analysis of energy use, energy and material balance and energy loss waste analysis. Step 7. Identification and development of energy conservation. ENCON opportunities. Identification and consolidation, ENCON measures, conceive, develop and refine ideas, review and previous ideas suggested by unit personnel, review the previous ideas suggested by energy audit, if any, use brainstorming and value analysis techniques, contact vendor for new efficient technology. Next, step 8, cost benefit analysis. Analysis technical feasibility, economic viability and prioritization of ENCON option for implementation. Select the most promising projects, prioritized by low, medium, long term measures. Step 9, reporting and presenting to the top management. Documentation report presentation to the top management. Step 10, that is the post audit phase. Implementation and follow up. Assist and implement ENCON recommendations, that is energy conservation measurements, measures and monitor the performances. Action plan schedule for implementation, follow up and periodic review. Next important thing, that is energy audit procedure. First, establish audit scope, formation of audit team, audit plan, checklist preparation, initial walkthrough, collecting of available data and energy bills, preliminary analysis, data inventory and measurement, energy usage pattern analysis, demand profile, benchmarking and comparison, identification of EMOs, cost benefit assessment, writing audit and report and recommendations, action plan preparation and implementation the action. So first one, the pre-audit phase, that is EMO, preliminary data collection, flow diagram and energy utility diagram. Then EMO visit, that is site visit. Then second is executive phase. Then third is post-audit phase. So this is the way the full audit, energy audit procedure is done. Next, understanding energy cost. Understanding energy cost is vital factor for awareness, creation and saving calculations. In many industries, sufficient meters may not be available to measure all the energy used. In such cases, invoices of fuel and electricity will be useful. The annual company balance sheet is the other source where fuel cost and power are given with production related information. Energy invoices can be used for the following purpose. They provide a record of energy purchased in a given year, which gives a final baseline for future references. Energy invoices may indicate the potential for savings when related to production requirement or to air conditioning requirement, space heating, etc. When electricity is produced on the basis of maximum demand tariff, they can suggest when savings are mostly likely to be made. In later years, invoices can be used for quantifying the energy and cost savings made through energy conservation measures. Fuel cost. Availability, cost and quality are the main three factors that should be considered while purchasing. The following factors which should be taken into account during procurement of fuel for energy efficiency and economics. Price at source, transport charges, type of transport, quality of fuel, contaminations, moisture, etc., energy content, calorific value. Next, power cost. Electricity price in India not only varies from state to state, but also city to city and consumer to consumer. Though it does the same work everywhere, many factors are involved in deciding the final cost of purchased electricity, such as maximum demand charges, KVA, that is how fast the electricity is used. Bureau of Energy Efficiency, 713 Energy Management and Audit, and electric charge, energy charges per kilowatt hour, how much electricity is consumed. TOD, peak, non-peak period, that is when electricity is utilized. Power factor charge, PF, real power versus apparent power use factor. The incentives and penalties applied from time to time. High tension tariff and low tension tariff rate charges. Slab rate cost and its variation. Type of tariff, causes, clause and rate for various categories such as commercial, residential, industrial, government, agricultural, etc. Tariff rate for developed and underdeveloped areas, states. Tax holiday for new projects. tax holidays for new projects. Next, benchmarking. Benchmarking of energy consumption is a powerful tool for performing assessment and logical evaluation of possibilities of improvement. It is done in two ways, internally and externally. Internal benchmarking. Internal method involves historical or trend analysis. Historical data, well documented, helps to bring out energy consumption and cost trends method month-wise or day-wise. Trend analysis of energy consumption, cost-relevant production, features specific energy consumption, helps to understand effects of capacity utilization on energy use, efficiency and cost on a broader scale. External benchmarking. External benchmarking relates to inter-unit comparison across a group of similar units. Few comparative factors which need to be looked into while benchmarking externally are scale of operation, vintage of technology, raw material specification and quality, product specification and quality. Next is energy performances. Benchmarking energy performance permits quantification of fixed and variable energy consumption, trends vice versa, production levels, comparison of the industry energy performance with respect to various production levels, capacity utilization, identification of best practices based on the external benchmarking data, scope and margin available for energy consumption and cost reduction, basis for monitoring and large setting exercise. The benchmarking parameters can be gross production related, kilowatt per metric ton clinker on cement produced in cement plants, kilowatt per kg yarn produced in textile units, equipment utility related, kilowatt per ton of refrigeration on air conditioning plant, percentage thermal efficiency of a boiler. Plant energy performance. Plant energy performance PEP is a measure of whether a plant is now using more or less energy on manufacturing its production and it did in the past. It compares the change in energy consumption from one year to the other and considering production output. It compares plant energy use at reference year with the subsequent years to determine the improvement that can be made. It is necessary to determine the energy that would have to be required to produce this year production output if the plant had operated in the same way as it did during the reference year. This calculated value can then be compared with the actual value to determine the improvement or deterioration that has taken place since the reference year. Next, production factor. Production factor is used to determine the energy that would have been required to produce this year's production output if the plant had operated in the same way as it did in the reference year. It is the ratio of production in the current year to that of the reference year. Production factor, current year's production divided by reference year's production. Reference year's equivalent energy use. The reference year's energy use that would have been used to produce the current year's production output may be called the reference year energy use equivalent or reference year equivalent. For short, the reference year equivalent is obtained by multiplying the reference year energy use by the production factor obtained above. Reference year equivalent equal to reference year energy use into production factor. The improvement or deterioration from the reference year is called energy performance and is a measure of plant energy management progress. It is the reduction of or increase in the current year's energy use over the reference. production energy performance, reference year equivalent, current year's energy divided by reference year equivalent into 100. The energy performance is the percentage of energy saved at the current rate of the use compared to the reference year rate of use. The greater the improvement, the greater the number will be. Monthly energy performance. Experience, however, has shown that once a plant has started measuring yearly energy performance, management wants more frequent performance information in order to monitor and control energy use on an ongoing basis. PEP can just as easily be used for monthly monitoring as yearly monitoring. Matching energy use to requirement. Matching energy use to requirement is always necessary. If there is mismatch, it leads to inefficiency due to part load operations, wastage, etc. For example, optimizing is the energy manager's work and in many cases present themselves towards an energy involving graceful matching of energy requirement capacity to the end use needs. Some examples given are: eliminate the damper operations in fans by impeller timing, installation of variable speed drives, pulley diameter modification for belt drive, fan resizing for better efficiency, moderation of chilled water temperature for process chilling needs, recovery of energy lost in control valve pressure drops by back pressure or by turbine adoption. Adoption of task file lighting in places less effective area lighting. Maximizing system efficiency. After matching the energy usage and requirement properly, the next step is to operate the equipment efficiently through best practices in operation. The maintenance as well as latest technology adoption. Some examples are: replace pumps, fans or all compressors, refrigeration compressors, furnace, heaters and other energy consuming equipments. Wherever significant energy efficient margins exist, removing steam leakages by trap improvements in boilers, maximizing condensation recovery, maximizing combustion efficiency, optimizing the input energy requirements. After setting the energy use practices, consideration given for maximizing energy input requirement. Some examples are: periodic review of insulation thickness, shuffling of compressors to match needs, identify potential for networking and process integration, optimizing of transformer operations with respective loads. Fuel and energy substitution. Fuel substitution. The best method of energy optimization is substituting existing fossil fuels with more efficient, less cost and less polluting fuel such as natural gas, biogas and agro waste. Energy is as important input in the production. There are two ways to reduce energy dependency: energy conservation and substitution. Fuel substitution has taken place in all major factors of Indian economy, such as kerosene and liquefied petroleum gas has substituted soft coke in home use. Natural gas is used as fuel feedback in fertilizer, petrochemical, power and iron and steel industries, replacement of coal by coconut shells, rice husks, etc. Some examples of energy substitutions: replacement of steam-based hot water by solar system, replacement of energy electric heaters by steam heaters. Energy audit instruments. The requirement of an energy audit, such as identification and quantification of energy necessity, necessitates measurements. These measurements require the use of instruments. The most usual measured quantities in the energy audit are liquid and gas flows, electric parameters such as voltage, current and power factor, active power kilowatts, kilovolt hour, reactive power kilowatt hour, ampere, energy consumption kilowatt hour, frequency harmonics, etc., temperature and heat flow, radiation, pressure of fluids, speed, revolutions per minute, velocity, noise and vibration, dust concentration, total dissolved solids, pH, moisture content, relative humidity, flue gas analysis and combustion efficiency. Most important is the energy audit instruments. The requirement of an energy audit, such as identification and quantification of energy necessity, necessitates measurements. These measurement requires the use of instruments. The most usual measuring quantities in energy audit are liquid and gas flows, electrical parameters such as voltage, current, power factor, active power, kilowatt, kilovolt amps, reactive power, energy consumption kilowatt hour, frequency harmonics, etc., temperature and heat flow, radiation, pressure of fluids, speed, revolution per minute, RPM, velocity, noise and vibration, dust concentration, total dissolved solids, pH value, moisture content, relative humidity, flue gas analysis and combustion efficiency. An energy auditor should be well familiar with the measuring instruments in order to have knowledge of purchase, rent and use of the instrument. Some instruments can be used online, that is without switching off the process. Handheld instruments could be used for instant measurements. The commonly used instruments for energy auditing are combustion energy, combustion analysis, fuel analysis, monitoring, ferrite, contact thermometer, infrared thermometer, pitot tube and manometer, water flow meter, tachometer, ultrasonic leak detector, lux meter. Next, combustion analyzer. Combustion analyzer is a portable electronic instrument used for measurement of combustion efficiency of boilers, furnaces. They are battery powered and digital display and keyboard. The combustion analysis supporter measures flue gas, stack gas temperature, measure combustion air temperature, oxygen levels, carbon monoxide levels, NOx and SOx levels. Application: boilers, unit heaters, hot water heaters, process ovens, dryers and heaters. Next, fuel efficiency monitors. The equipment is used to find the combustion efficiency. This measures oxygen and temperature of the flue gases. Microprocessor is used to calculate the combustion efficiency and after receiving combustion efficiency and sensor input. Next, ferrite. By using a hand bellow pump flue gas, samples are sucked inside the ferrite, which has already chemical solutions inside. The chemical solutions react with the flue gases. This shows the amount of gases present in the flue gas. Aspirate ferrite is used for oxygen and carbon dioxide measurements. Contact thermometer. These thermometers, which measures temperature of flue gas, hot water. The probe is inserted in the flow path of the medium to be measured. For surface temperature, a leaf type probe is used with same instrument. The temperature is measured by using the thermocouple and calibrated to see the display. Infrared thermometer. This is the non-contact type measurement. It gives the temperature readings directly as a digital display, which is directed towards the heat source. This instrument is used for measuring hot spots in the furnace, surface temperatures, etc. Hello. சொல்லுங்க ஆமா அது இல்லை என்கிட்ட போதில்ல அப்படியா Pitot tube and manometer, velocity of air and fluids flowing through the ducts and tunnels can be measured using the Pitot tube and inclined manometer. Handheld digital manometer are available with data logging functions and digital display. Water flow meter. The non-contact flow measuring devices using Doppler effect ultrasonic principle. There is a transmitter and receiver which are positioned on opposite sides of the pipe. The meter directly gives the flow. Water and other fluid flows can be easily measured with this meter. Speed measurements. Energy audit requires tachometer to measure the speed of the motor or driven device. Contact type. A simple tachometer is the contact type instrument. It is used where direct access is possible. Non-contact type. Non-contact instruments are more sophisticated and safer. X-stroboscopes. It is a light sensor type. Leak detectors. Ultrasonic instruments are available which can be used to detect leaks of compressed air and other gases which are normally not possible to detect with human abilities. When gas is forced through a small opening, a leak is in a pressure or vacuum system, an ultrasonic sound is created. Direction of the sound is used to locate the source of leak. The ultrasonic leak detector is sensitively tuned to the frequency of sound. Application air leak around the door and window seals and gaskets, water leak to roof, leaks of vacuum vessels R and AC. Lux meter. Lux meter is used to measure illumination levels. It consists of photocells which senses the light output, which converts this light output to the electrical impulses, which can be calibrated as lux. Energy conservation techniques. Energy conservation means reduction in energy consumption, but without making any sacrifice of quality or quantity of production. As per a popular slogan, energy saved is energy generated. In fact, the energy saved is more than the energy generated, because the energy is saved at the user end, which includes savings of transmission, transportation losses, also apart from usable energy. Some of the techniques of energy conservation are recycling of waste, cogeneration, improving the technology, waste heat recovery. These are the four methods, need and importance of energy conservation. Economic aspect. Reduction in cost of product. By using energy conservation, the cost of production is reduced. In some energy intensive industries like steel, aluminium, cement, fertilizer, pulp and paper, etc., cost of energy forms a significant part of the total cost of product. This will reduce the manufacturing cost and lead to production of cheaper and better quality products. New job opportunities. Energy conservation usually requires a new investment in most efficient equipment to replace old inefficient ones. Monitoring of energy consumption, training of manpower, etc. The energy conservation can result in new job opportunities. Environmental aspect. Every type of energy generation process affects the environment to some extent, whether either directly or indirectly. The degradation of environment depends mainly on the types of primary energy source. In every energy conservation stages, a part of energy escapes to surroundings and appears in the form of heat. This energy is generated and utilized at the expense of adverse climatic environmental impacts. Adoption of energy conservation means can minimize this damage. Depletion of non-renewable energy assets. The bulk of energy used in the world today is derived from fossil fuels, which are non-renewable. These non-renewable assets are being used up very fast. In 1 minute, the world community uses the quantity of fuel which tools the earth a millionth of millions to create. Therefore, its prices are bound to go up relatively to everything else. We must abandon wasteful practices in every utilization and conservation. Conserve this source by all means for future generation. Principles of energy conservation. Use of technology to meet the emission norms as per government policy and orders. Procurement of energy at minimum cost by maximizing the use of cheaper and easily available form of energy. Manage energy use at higher energy efficiency. Use of waste heat recovery system. Reduce the energy losses during energy transfer process. Process efficiency improvement, cogeneration, reuse of waste. Methods of energy conservation. Recycling of waste. Every finished product has an intrinsic value depending upon the original energy input during its production process. For example, newspaper material has more gained energy than the energy in the raw material that goes into making the paper. Reducing the waste and reclaiming the useful waste material by its recycling can save that invisible energy which has been used in production and processing material. It has three benefits: saving of energy, extraction of some amount of new material also displaced. It also solves the problem of waste disposal of the great extent. Modernization technology. Developed countries have been able to reduce the energy consumption significantly compared to developing countries by adopting energy efficient modern technology. Wasteful heat utilization. Various energy processes require heat of different grades. Waste heat from one process can be served the need for the other, which requires heat at low grade. Let us consider an example of glass industry. The glass industry requires heat to melt the glass at about 1500 degree centigrade. It produces waste heat at about 400 to 500 degree centigrade in the form of flue gas from the furnace. Flue gases may then be used to raise the medium pressure steam and fed into the back pressure boiler steam to generate electric power. The exhaust from the back pressure steam which is about 120 degree centigrade may further be used for crop drying or for paper drying. The condensed water vapor which is about 60 degree centigrade may also be used for heating space, fish farm or greenhouses. Proper housekeeping, judicial use of proper types of energy. Although all forms of energy are expressed in the same unit, joules, the financial value of energy varies enormously with its grading. Some of the energy forms are mentioned here in decreasing order of grading. Electricity, top grading energy, mechanical energy, second grade, thermal energy, last grade. For economic reasons, one should never use the high grade energy than required. For example, electricity energy should not be used for heating purpose instead of thermal energy which can be obtained directly by burning the fuel or by solar thermal system may be used. Judicial use of proper type of fuel. Cheaper primary source should be preferred wherever possible in case of costly one. For example, coal and biofuel may be obtained directly by burning or fuel or by solar thermal system can be used. Cogeneration. Cogeneration should be used wherever feasible and economically viable instead of separate generation of electricity and heat. In some industries, cogeneration may result in 30% lower fuel consumption as compared to that where electricity and heat are generated separately. Training of manpower. Manpower should be trained to adopt habits in efficient use of energy. Adopting daylight saving light. Daylight saving time may be adopted to save a significant amount of energy during a certain season in a year. In summer, when the sun rises early, the clock may be set 1 hour ahead of the local standard time. This increases the number of useful hours of daylight and provides extra sunlight in the evening. Due to this, daily activities of many people are over earlier and bedtime comes soon after it is dark. As a result, they do not have to use the artificial light and could save fuel and electricity. Proper operation and maintenance. Leakages must be carefully plugged in. Proper lubrication should be maintained in moving parts. Proper thermal insulation should be utilized in internal insulation. Cogeneration and its application. The cogeneration system in a single integrated system in which many forms of useful energy are simultaneously generated, mostly electrical or mechanical and thermal, using single source of fuel. A cogeneration system is also called a combined heat pump, heat power, CHP system. Cogeneration uses fuel in a thermally efficient way. In conventional electricity generation, some part of energy is lost as a waste heat, but this thermal energy is readily used in cogeneration. The CHP system can be categorized typically by the type of prime mover, heat engine, which is driving the overall system. Moreover, main parts which collectively from the CHP are prime mover, generator, heat recovery system, and the figure shows schematic of general cogeneration system. Here the fuel is taken as vegetable oil or broom thread, natural gas, coal, biomass, biogas, Then cogeneration plant generates by engine, by it is operated as engine generator, gas turbo generation, steam turbine generation, power and heat. So by cogeneration plus, this much output is got up. That is power and heat. Steam generated turbines, gas turbines, reciprocating engines are some of the prime movers used for CHP. The prime movers produce mechanical energy by burning various fuels such as coal, oil, natural gas, etc. Mechanical energy of prime mover is utilized to drive the generator to produce electricity, as well as rotary equipment such as fan, pumps, compressors, etc. Need for cogeneration. It is well accepted fact that the main source of energy, that is fuel, are non-renewable and depleting very fast. Prices of fuel are trending to be really high since last 25 to 30 years, putting ahead of challenge to developing nations to save the energy and primary fuels such as they can and make them last longer. Need of cogeneration identifies where heat and electrical energy are simultaneously required in the same premises. It is the traditional method. Two separate input paths are used to attain the requirement of electricity and heat, which can be observed in figure. Enormous amount of fuel is sacrificed in this process of producing electricity and heat definitely. Moreover, these separately processed attributes to emission of pollutants and greenhouse gases in the considerable amounts. Necessity of generation of thermal energy on the place where it is needed. Utility of burden as system demands not only erection but also maintenance of transmission and distribution or network. Cogeneration can begin the form of distributed generation electric power, and heat can be supplied at the site by designing a suitable energy tariff in the country. Ultimately, it can be said that generation, it is the way of energy conservation in the most effective and effective way. Classification of the cogeneration system. Detailed classification of cogeneration schemes based on various criteria can be observed in the following chart. According to the sequence of energy use of cogeneration system is classified as topping cycle and bottoming cycle. Topping cycle. In the topping cycle, utilization of fuel burnt is mainly for the production of electricity and excess thermal energy is recovered. Heat energy is generated as the byproduct of the cycle, which is used for attaining thermal requirements or satisfying process. So first fuel is used for generating electricity by moving the prime mover and generates electricity, and the waste is again used for heat. The heat is used for thermal energy generation. Combined cycle system. Basically, fuel and air is burnt in a combustion chamber and combustion gases thus produced. Mechanical and electrical power is generated by association of rotary engine or gas turbines. In the next stage, heat recovery boiler generates steam, which is utilized to drive the secondary steam turbines. So there are two turbines that generate low heat and as well as with high heat. So that is called a combined topping cycle. Advantages: additional energy gain, energy conservation, power generated in greenhouse with much better efficiency, lesser cost because of high overall thermal efficiency of the plant. Electrical power generated via cogeneration does not have to be transmitted over a long distance as it is used in the vicinity. Reliability, less environmental impact, waste recovery, decentralization of electrical generation. Application of cogeneration. Cogeneration can be find its use mainly in the areas like sugar mills, rice mills, petrochemical sector, distilleries, cement, pulp and paper, aluminium industries, etc. Concept of energy management. The effective use of energy to maximize profits, minimize cost and enhance competitive positions. Objectives of energy management. Conserving energy, thereby reducing cost, developing and maintaining effective monitoring, reporting and management strategies for efficient energy usage, finding new and better ways to increase returns from energy investment through R&D. Need for energy management. Estimates say the industrial energy use in developing countries like India constitutes about 45-50% of the total commercial energy consumption. These are mainly meet out from the imported crude oils. So developing countries spent around 50% of their foreign exchange of oil import. So India has to concentrate on energy management concepts. Energy coal savings of 5-15% is as easily obtained by energy management. So energy management is the most promising profit improvement cost reduction method in industry. Study of different energy management techniques. Analysis of input. For all energy management techniques, the efficiency of the system is studied. The efficiency mainly depends on input and output. The input parameters are carefully studied and optimized. The method of reducing the input energy for the same output it is used. Use of latest modern and energy efficient techniques is needed. Energy lost at input level is minimized. Reuse and recycling of waste. Reuse. It is the method of using an item more than once. It is of two types. Use of item again for the same purpose. Use of item for the new purpose. Advantages. It saves energy and raw materials, reduces disposable, reduced cost savings of business and consumers, since reusable product is cheaper. Older items can be better handled, handcrafted and value added. Recycle. It is a process of breaking down of old items into raw material and process them to use as material for new products. This will reduce consumption of fresh or virgin raw materials. Recycling is the method of modern waste management techniques. Recycling methods include glass, paper, metals, plastics, textiles and electronic gadgets. Materials to be recycled are picked up from a curbside, sorted, cleaned and reprocessed into clean raw material suitable for manufacturing new products. Advantages. Reduced energy usage, reduced air pollution, reduced water pollution, reduced greenhouse effect. Economic approach of energy consumption. In energy conservation system, the existing system is first studied for its cost. The cost of the output produced is calculated first. This is compared with the other cost or methods of production of the same output. Used for production of output is studied in the basis of cost economics. If some cheap methods are available, then they can be used. For example, if the latest energy efficient technology is available, it should be used. Costing of utilization like steam, compressed air, electricity and water. Determination of steam. Effective cost of steam is dependent from the boiler to the point of use to the next path. consider system approach and entire boiler design, including the effect of blowdown, peristaltic steam consumption, de-aeration, etc. Furthermore, there are complications arise due to process steam load at different pressures, multiple boilers and waste heat recovery system. In order to determine the effective cost of steam, use simultaneous model simulation model of combined heat and power. Multi-fuel capability. For multi-fuel capability, boilers are analyzing the regular steam generation cost using the variation of the fuel price, and it uses a fuel that provide a minimum of steam generation cost, higher versus lower heating values. Fuels is solid on the basis of its gross sold on, is fuel is sold on its basis of its gross or higher heating value. For example, at the end of the combustion process in the form of steam is water. The higher heating value must be reduced by the latent heat or vaporization of water. This reduced value has been known as the lower heating value, benchmark of the fuel cost of steam generation. Energy requires the process of 1 pound of saturated steam is given in the tabular column. Similarly, energy content, the natural gas distillate residual cost. So how much energy is wasted and what much cost is given in this tabular column. The above mentioned data proves useful in determining the cost availability heat from the boiler. The calculation will also be available, included the operational costs count as the accessories, water supply pump, fan, fuel atomizer, soot blowing, chemical treatment and environmental maintenance. Here is an example given for the boiler as well as for the compressor, determination of cost of compressor operations. It's a numerical example, just you can go through it. Next, determination of cost of water. The total cost of water includes water bill, treatment cost and pumping cost. If the water is wasted and not recycled, its cost will go increasing. Poor maintenance of pump will also lead to extra cost. Water needs treatment before use. If it is wasted, total cost increases as the fresh water needs treatment. Loss of water from cooling tower, washing areas adds cost to industry. Ways to ways of improving boiler efficiency. It's very important and will be useful for your when you are going for a work at thermal power plant or boiler operator. So first on the one, monitoring feed water quality. The quality of boiler feed water affects the overall boiler performance and helps the boiler efficiency. Poor feed water quality increases TDS level. The boiler drum increases TDS calls for more blowdown, which results in increased blowdown losses and lower boiler efficiency. Monitoring and maintaining the feed water quality helps efficient operation of boiler. Boiler sizing. If the boiler is oversized, it is results in frequent on-off. Every time a boiler shuts down and restarts, boiler efficiency comes down drastically. Blowdown control and plant heat recovery from blowdown. In order to maintain the TDS level within the specified limits, we need to drain a lot of water from boiler drum with higher salt concentration and replace it with fresh water. Draining out with water from boiler drum results in loss of energy, as the water inside will be hot and pressurized. Water from blowdown water should be recovered by using blowdown vessel. Furnace draft tuning. Pressure inside the boiler furnace should be tuned properly. -2 to -5 mm of water column for small boilers to get a good boiler efficiency. If the pressure falls below -5, it will result to increased unburnt losses and will bring down the boiler efficiency. Excess air increases the enthalpy losses, and as the result, the boiler efficiency goes down. For proper combustion of fuel inside the furnace, certain amount of air is required. If sufficient quantity of air is supplied, the carbon present in the fuel is incompletely oxidized to carbon monoxide, and less amount of heat is released, which brings down the overall efficiency of the fuel. If the excess air is more than the required, then this air absorbs the energy by absorbing the heat from combustion, and this energy is lost along with the flue gases, which again brings down the boiler efficiency. Fuel quality. If fuel has high moisture content, the boiler efficiency will come down. Bring down the boiler efficiency. Fuel quality. If the fuel has high moisture content, the boiler efficiency will come down. In case of solid fuel, drying the fuel before combustion improves the boiler efficiency. Tube cleaning. Cleaning boiler tubes periodically removes the soot and scales and improves the efficiency of the heat transfer and results in improved boiler efficiency. Online monitoring of boiler. Using an online efficiency monitoring system of our boiler can give insight about actual real-time efficiency and can generate suggestions to improve the boiler efficiency based on that. Boiler automation ensures the boiler operating only in the safest and most efficient way, and hence significantly improves the boiler efficiency. Heat recovery from exhaust. Flue gases come out from the boiler contains considerable amount of heat due to their hot temperature. This energy from the hot flue gases can be recovered and used to heat feed water. This system improves the boiler efficiency. Next, the thermal insulation. Purpose of thermal insulation. Heat loss from the pipe can be reduced by covering it with a material having low thermal conductivity. Insulation in used building and in manufacturing process to prevent heat loss or heat gain. Reduce the overall energy consumption. Gives better process control by maintaining process temperature. Types of application. The insulation can be classified into three groups according to the temperature range of which they are used. Low temperature insulation up to 90 degrees centigrade. This range covers insulating materials for refrigerators, cold and hot water systems, storage tanks, etc. The commonly used material are coke, wood, mineral fibers, polyurethane and expanded polyethylene, etc. Medium temperature insulation. Insulators in this range are used in low temperature heating and steam raising equipments, steam lines, flue ducts, etc. The type of material used in this temperature range includes asbestos, calcium silicate and mineral fibers, etc. High temperature insulation, the 325 degrees and above. Typical use of such materials are superheated steam, oven, dryers and furnace, etc. The most extensively used material in this in this range as asbestos, calcium silicate, mineral fiber, mica and vermiculite based insulation, fire clay and ceramic fiber. Critical thickness of insulation. The critical radius affect in the interesting phenomena of heat transfer in insulated pipes. Insulating a cylinder or sphere large than the critical radius has the expected effect of regarding the heat loss. If the radius of the cylinder or sphere is smaller than the critical radius, adding insulation will actually increase the heat loss. The additional insulation increases the conduction resistance of the insulation layer but decreases the convection insulation of the resistance of the soot surface because of the increase in the outer surface area for convection. Therefore, the net heat transfer from the pipe may increase or decrease depending on which the effect dominates. Critical radius is independent of the radius of the circular pipe or tube. It depends on the conductivity insulation K and the convective heat transfer coefficient H between exposed surface of insulation and its surroundings. The value of critical radius RC will be the largest when conductivity of insulation K is large and convectional heat transfer H is small. Figure illustrates the critical radius of insulation around the cylinder representing total convective and insulation radiation. The radii R1 and R2 represents the cylinder and the insulating respectively. Critical radius of insulation RC is 2K by H. With the increase in the thickness of insulation, total heat resistance will first decrease, attain the minimum value and then increases gradually. The purpose of insulation is to reduce the total resistance first decreases, attains minimum value and then increases gradually. The purpose of insulation is to reduce the total unwanted radial heat dissipation, hence the optimum thickness of the insulation should be greater than the critical thickness of insulation and should be economical. Provide greater thickness of insulation is not economically viable due to its high cost. Waste heat recovery. Waste heat is created by the byproduct of industrial process. By industrial process that involves transforming raw material into finished product, steel mills, paper plant, refineries, thermochemical, thermal plant, oil and gas pipelines and general manufacturing heat. Heat is wasted as the result. Waste heat is defined as the heat which is generated in a process by way of chemical reaction of fuel combustion. Waste heat generated or produced during the fuel combustion can be reused for some useful or economical purposes. Waste heat can lower utility than the original heat source. Definition: waste heat recovery means to recover the heat released as a byproduct of a process for providing the necessary heat to the second step. It is the process of recovering heat from the heat stream with potential high energy content such as hot flue gases from diesel generators or steam from cooling towers or even waste heat from different cooling processes such as the steel cooling. Classification of waste heat recovery, WHR, can be achieved by heat exchangers. Waste heat recovery can be classified into three categories depending upon the temperature involved: high temperature heat recovery, medium temperature heat recovery, low temperature heat recovery. High temperature heat exchangers with fluid temperatures above 650 degrees centigrade. when the combustion of hydrocarbon fuels, let's say, takes place, the produce that produces gases is in the high temperature range. Table shows the temperature of waste gases from the process equipment in the high temperature range. From the table, it is understood that cement, aluminium, open earth furnace, hydrogen plants, so these produces high amount of heat. Next one, medium energy recovery. Medium temperature heat recovery. In this temperature range, most of the range of waste heat generally comes from the exhaust of directly fired process units. Mthur is still hot enough to allow extraction of mechanical work from it by the gas turbines of steam. Heat exchangers with fluid temperature range from 230 degrees centigrade or medium temperature heat exchangers. Incinerators is examples of medium temperature heat recovery system. The table indicates the temperature of waste gases from some processes apparent to the medium temperature. Reciprocating engine with exhaust turbocharged, steam boiler exhaust, drying and baking ovens, reciprocating exhaust engines. Low temperature heat recovery. Fluid temperature less than 230 degrees centigrade or the low temperature heat exchangers. In this particular range, it is not possible that the production of steam is completely eliminated. If the low temperature steam is needed in order to extract work from the source, it is not usually practical. Lower temperature waste heat may be useful in preheating purposes such as preheating of ventilation air with exhaust air. Low temperature air compressors, pumps, forming drives, air conditioning, refrigeration. So these are the areas where we can recover low temperatures by waste heat pump. Benefits of waste heat recovery. Recovery of waste heat increases efficiency of the process. Recovery of water heat reduces the requirement of space heating energy. This is reflected by reduction cost consumption of utilities, reduction in equipment sizes. Waste heat recovery reduces fuel consumption that leads to the reduction in the flue gas generation. This leads to a reduction in unit size of all flue gas delivery devices such as fans, stack, burners, etc. Reduction in pollution, reduction in auxiliary energy consumption. Waste heat recovery applications. Medium to high temperature exhaust gases can be used to preheat the combustion or air for boilers, furnaces, gas turbine ovens. Low to medium temperature exhaust gases can be used to preheat energy saving devices. Only the gas, liquid water, boiler, feed water. The exhaust gas can be used to generate steam in the waste heat boiler to generate electric power. Mechanical process steam and any combination therefore. Waste heat can be used to operate an absorption cooling unit for air conditioning or refrigeration. Waste heat devices. Some of the waste heat devices are recuperators, regenerators, heat wheels, heat pipe economizer, shell and tube heat exchanger, direct contact heat exchanger, plate heat exchanger, heat pump, waste heat boilers. Recuperators. It is shown in the figure. It's a similar type of heat exchanger, but the way of arranging of tubes, which the hot air and cold air flows in the cross section. In this heat exchanger takes place between the flue gas and the air through metallic or ceramic valves. Ducts or tubes carry the air for combustion to be preheated, and other side contains the waste heat stream. A recuperator for recovering waste heat from gases shown in figure. Metallic radiator recuperator. The simplest type of radiator is the metallic type of radiator. Metallic radiation recuperator, which consists of two concentric lengths of metal tubes as shown in figure. The inner tube carries the hot flue gases. External annulus carries the combustion of air from atmosphere to the air inlet in the furnace burners. In this recuperator, hot gases are cooled by incoming combustion air. This carries additional energy to the combustion chamber. The additional energy which does not have to be supplied by the fuel. Hence, the less fuel is burnt for giving the furnace loading. Savings in fuel also means decrease in combustion air and therefore stack losses and decreases not used by lowering stack gases temperature but by also by discharging smaller quantities of exhaust gas. Advantages of metallic recuperator: reduced fuel cost by using preheated air in burners, long service life for recuperators, short and attractive payback period, higher furnace flame temperature, less maintenance, customized design for specific application. Application: heat treatment furnace, forced reheat furnace, ceramic clinks, rotary metallic melting furnaces, non-ferrous melting. Criteria for installing a unit: heat loss quality. Depending upon the type of process, waste heat can be rejected at the virtually any temperature from that of the chilled cooling water to high temperature waste generate waste gases from the industrial furnace or clink. Usually higher the temperature, higher the quality and more cost effective is the heat recovery. For any waste heat recovery, there should be some use for recovered heat. Example: preheating of combustion air, space heating or preheating boiler feed water. For high temperature heat recovery, cascade system is used so that fuel heat recovery is maximum. Heat loss quantity: in any heat recovery, the amount of heat recoverable should be known. Based on this, the capacity of installing unit is decided. An introduction approach to energy conservation. Compressed air: ensure air intake to compressor is not warm and humid by locating compressor in a well ventilated area. Clean air filters regularly. This will increase efficiency. Maintain compressor valves in good condition. Installing manometer across the filters and monitoring the pressure drop. Replace the filter if the pressure drop is more. Avoid low volt compressor operation. Use regenerative dryers which utilizes the heat of compressed air to remove moisture. Clean the intercoolers periodically. Fouled intercoolers will reduce the compressor efficiency and cause water condensation, which results in corrosion. Whenever possible, reduce the compressor air delivery pressure. This, in case of large compressor, the heat from the hot compressed air is used to generate hot air economically. Carry out periodical leak test and estimate the amount of leakage. If the load point is too far from the central compressor houses, then use of dedicated compressor is preferable. If the pressure requirements for processed are different, then the use separate compressed air systems. Refrigeration and air conditioning. Cold insulation. Insulation insulate all cold lines and vessels to minimize heat absorption. Building envelope. Optimize volume of air conditioning. Use false ceiling and air curtains and segregate critical areas of air conditioning. Building heat load minimization. Minimize the air conditioning loads. Use of roof cooling, roof painting, efficient lighting, pre-cooling of fresh air by air-to-air heat exchangers, sun film stickers, etc. Process heat load minimization. Minimize process heat loads in terms of TR capacity as well as refrigeration level by the way of flow optimization, increase in heat transfer area to have higher temperature coolant, avoid wastage like heat absorption, loss of chilled water, idle flows, cleaning and descaling of compressors. Refrigeration AC plant areas. Maintain the AC plant as well as per guidelines. Ensure adequate quantity of chilled water and its flow. Avoid bypass flows. Minimize part load operations by matching loads and power capacity on the line. Adopt variable speed drives for varying process load. Optimize condensed evaporator parameters for minimizing specific energy consumption and maximizing capacity. Pumps. Operate pumps near best efficiency point. Modify pumping system and pump losses to minimize throttling. Use variable loads with variable speeds drives for sequential control of multiple valves. Use booster pumps for small load requiring higher pressures. Repair seals and gaskets and minimize water loss by leaking. Avoid pumping head with free fall return. Replace old pump with energy efficient pumps. Avoid cooling water recirculation in all equipments. Reduce system resistance by pressure drop assessment and pipe sizing optimization. Fans. Minimize energy air levels in combustion system to reduce FD and ID fan loads. Minimize hot and cold air in the in and out leaks. Change the impeller with high efficiency one long width impeller. Change the fan assembly with large efficiency fan impeller derating by a smaller diameter impeller. Change the GRP impeller with FRP with a airfoil design. Use variable speed drives for variable duty conditions. Use energy efficient flat belt or cocked raw edged V belt instead of V belts. Minimize system resistance and pressure drops by improving the duct system design. So by this unit, energy conservation is various areas such as thermal plant and in compressors, pumps, where all mechanical equipment operates, we have to adopt energy conservation methods and as well as waste heat recovery plus energy savings techniques. So this has to be adopted in future for energy conservation. Thank you for your patient listening. Thank you.